the About Race panel. Thank you so much for joining us. On June 2nd, 2020, Skate Canada released a statement on anti-racism. This statement expressed our commitment to anti-racism and to leading by example within the sport community. Over the last month, Skate Canada has taken time to start educating ourselves and lay the foundations to listen to the voices of Black, Indigenous, and people of color, and to be able to bring positive change to our sport. We know we have a responsibility to take decisive action, to acknowledge and address systemic racism, and to create a safe and welcoming environment for all individuals to embrace the joy of skating. We know we need to do more to accomplish that vision and are actively working to make Skate Canada as diverse and inclusive as possible. One of the actions taken is the creation by the Skate Canada Board of Directors per its bylaws of the Equity, Diversity and Inclusion Working Group. The EDI Working Group makes its recommendations to the organization via the President, Board and CEO. I am Tina Chen, and as a member of the EDI Working Group, I am pleased to welcome you to the first Talking About Race panel. We recognize the importance of two pillars: education for anti-racism in EDI, and listening to voices of BIPOC people as the foundation for change. Today's panel is an opportunity for all of us to hear the voices of racialized individuals in skating, and for their voices to inform our educational journeys and collective conversations. Thank you so much for joining us. During tonight's premiere of the panel, the YouTube Q&A function will be available for participants to join the conversation, and representatives from the EDI Working Group will be available to respond to written questions and comments. It is now my pleasure to introduce our moderators and the panelists. We are so honored to have joining us this evening Uzoma Asaguera. Uzoma, pronouns they, theirs, is a former basketball player with the University of Winnipeg and the Canadian National Basketball Team. Uzoma is currently an elected representative in the Manitoba Legislative Assembly and a leading voice for social justice. Thank you so much for joining us this evening, Uzoma, and sharing your time with us. Our panelists this evening include Alaj Balde, pronoun he, hims. Alaj was a member of the Canadian figure skating team from 2007 to 2018, and he was the 2008 Junior Men's Canadian Champion. He retired as a competitive in 2018. He is founder of Skate Global and co-founder and president of the Figure Skating Diversity and Inclusion Alliance. Welcome, Alaj. Patrick Chan, pronouns he, him. Patrick is the most decorated male figure skater in Canadian history, with 3 Olympic medals, 3 world championship crowns, and 10 Canadian titles. He retired from the competitive sphere in 2018 and currently provides coaching and choreography services in the Vancouver area. Welcome, Patrick. Vanessa James, pronouns she, hers. Vanessa James is a French-Canadian pair skater. She has represented France at 2 Olympic Winter Games, most recently placing 5th in 2018. Vanessa James is a global ambassador for the Figure Skating Diversity and Inclusion Alliance. So pleased to have you join us, Vanessa. Andrea Sitar, pronouns she, hers. Andrea Sitar is an active member of the synchronized skating community for the last 20 years. She competed with Black Ice, one of Canada's most decorated synchronized skating teams, from 2005 to 2007. She currently works in the finance industry and is also a Skate Canada coach and section volunteer. Thank you for joining us, Andrea. Megan Wing, pronoun she, hers. Megan Wing is an Olympic ice dancer and was prominent on the Canadian ice dance scene for more than a decade, finishing on the Canadian podium for 10 consecutive years from 1997 to 2006. In 2006, she retired from competitive skating and remains active in the sport as one of Canada's top ice dance coaches. Welcome, Megan. It is such a pleasure to have this wonderful panel joining us today for our Talking About Race series, and I will now turn it over to Uzoma Asaguera.
Wonderful. Thank you, Tina. Can we give a round of applause to Tina? It has been absolutely amazing, amazing in pulling this all together. So thank you, Tina. Wonderful to see everybody here virtually. I mean, we're still in this pandemic. And so as challenging as it is, I think it is actually really, it's a good tool. It's a good way for us to be able to have this conversation in a manner that is hopefully more accessible. And, you know, that folks will be able to engage kind of wherever they are, because I think this is a conversation that is not just happening here or wherever we're situated, but certainly it's a global conversation. And over the many events of the past several months and throughout the summer, I'm certainly seeing, as I know many folks on the panel we've discussed previously, you know, these conversations are happening right now, and they're happening in spaces and in places in ways they haven't before. So I'm really excited to be able to moderate today. I think you're all just outstanding people and tremendous athletes. And so I look forward to getting into this. Before we get started, I want to make sure that I acknowledge the land that I'm situated on. I'm here in Winnipeg, Manitoba, in Treaty One territory, traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji Cree, Dakota, and Dene people, and homeland of the Métis Nation. I think it's really important that we acknowledge and we recognize the original, the traditional lands that we are gathered on, that we live and reside on, and especially when we're having conversations, tough conversations about race, about racism, discrimination, oppression, systemic discrimination, and those realities, that we make sure that we're cognizant of the original peoples of this land and the systems of oppression that have disproportionately impacted those folks who are original to these territories. So without any further dialogue, really from me, because everybody really wants to hear from you folks, how's everybody doing today? How's everybody feeling? Can we go around and just do a quick check-in? How's everybody feeling?
Well, I feel great. I'll go first. I feel great. I feel really privileged and honored to have this conversation. And thank you, Zoma, for being with us. It's a pleasure and an honor to have this dialogue with you. And I'm excited to share. I'm excited to hear experiences from my colleagues here on this panel. And I'm excited to get it started.
Awesome. And Andrea, how are you feeling today?
I'm feeling great. I'm just really humbled right now to be sitting on a panel with such high esteemed skaters and yourself, Izoma. Thank you so much for doing this for us. Looking forward to the stories we're going to share and what we're going to say.
Okay. Megan, we'll go to you next.
Sure. I'm great. And me too. I'm excited and honored as well to be included in this group. And I think it's just an exciting opportunity for all of us to take part in.
Wonderful. Vanessa?
Hi, everyone. I'm doing well. Thank you for having me. I'm really excited to get into these conversations with such beautiful people with such open hearts. So thank you for having me.
And last but certainly not least, Patrick.
Well, yeah, I'm part of this. And what a great way to see the positive in this global pandemic and have a chance to reflect and have a chat about it.
Definitely. Okay, so I'm really, the first place I'd like to start, if everyone's cool with that, I'd really like to get into how this conversation really got started within the skating community, within competitive skating, and why now. As someone who, my background in athletics is really more in basketball, I've never competitively skated in my life, and I'm not ever going to attempt to. I don't want to hurt myself. But certainly I've seen in basketball as an example, WNBA is a good example. Those athletes have been vocal about systemic discrimination, racism, sexism. They've been very active in activism within their sport for, probably a decade. And so now we see other sports, I don't want to say catching up, but kind of really having these conversations themselves. And so why do you think it is that now in skating, this conversation around race, discrimination, representation, why do you think it's starting and taking place during this time? And maybe we'll start with Vanessa, if that's okay.
Sure. I think this all started with the George Floyd killing with Ahmaud Arbery. And it was during the pandemic when everyone was at home and they had to listen. They couldn't be distracted by work and everything else. And I know it hit hard for me. It was one after the other. You didn't have time to just let it settle or forget or, it was back after back, back to back to back. With Breonna Taylor, mm-hmm. and people were listening, people were talking about it. And I think it was the time for skaters to realize, this affects us too. And so I think that's where it started. And I remember making a post about it because I've always been, we're in skating, it's always about being politically correct and diplomatic and, you know, not making people uncomfortable. And so I was debating, like, should I post something? And I said, I need to post something. I need to voice this, you know? And I got a lot of support from our skating community, but I got a lot of horrible comments. And I think that was the first time I really, really experienced racism. I know there was a Russian forum that, you know, kind of reposted on a news article or something like that. And I just had voices streaming of hatred and monkeys and things like that. Like, and at some point I was like, this is what I needed to see, that it exists, and it exists for me too. So that's where it started for me.
Okay. And Patrick, how about yourself?
Well, it's of course due to the events over the summer. It's given us an opportunity to look back to the beginnings in the sport, and looking at all the microaggressions that I never realized and kind of suppressed because I've been taught to follow along and not create issues and not bring up issues and just to be politically correct and always looking like everything is fine on the surface. But with getting older and now reflecting on events that have recently happened, it's opened my eyes, and I've now seen many, many occasions where injustice was present.
Okay. And Elaj, how about you?
Sure. To piggyback off of both Vanessa and Patrick, I think the murder of George Floyd really sparked a worldwide rise in consciousness and awareness of the Black experience and what racism looks like in our world. And I think for me, what really started the dialogue for me was, first of all, my personal looking back on my experience and how does this look like in my life, and all these, you know, all these concepts that were coming up at the forefront of everyone's conversation. Those are things that I had learned at a young age. Systemic racism, I saw it in my dad. I saw it affect him since I was a kid. And so I always understood these things from a perspective of society, but I didn't necessarily think of looking into what it looks like in figure skating. And that moment where the conversation kind of started, I saw the rise in consciousness, and I saw that finally voices were, people were listening. There was finally a moment where the reality of the experience of racism was something that people acknowledged and listened to. And I think for me, that was a moment to step in to that space and continue that dialogue and start that dialogue in areas that potentially haven't started yet. And there was a few friends of mine that shared experiences with me and some things that they experienced in the figure skating world. And I just felt like it was the time to jump into that conversation and to get figure skating to talk about it, because it's extremely it's important work.
I think it's something that's really important, something that's actually really key in this conversation and more broadly, because I've certainly heard from people and I've had conversations with folks in my own circles that these problems have been around forever. You know, we've seen dozens of these videos. And so for folks to act like this is brand new seems kind of ridiculous. But I think, Elaj, you just said something really important. You said people are listening, that now it seems like people are listening. And I think that is maybe a shift for many groups, many individuals, that I completely understand the desire to, you know, capitalize on that specific, you know, thing. Andrea, Megan, how about you folks? What kind of started this for you?
I was thrilled actually to see when Skate Canada released a statement, and I saw it on Instagram that, you know, they're taking measures to start listening and learning. And I thought that was really important, because my whole life growing up in a world of figure skating, it was unheard of, and you just kind of went along with it. So it was just like, finally, we're here. We made it. We're going to talk about it. I hope it continues and it's not just a trend that, you know, people are doing right now, because it is being heard. It is being publicized more. And I just want it to continue on a positive role and not just have these important conversations and discussions and we go back.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I think that through the summer and the outrage being so horrified, and just that was felt like a communal experience, and there was such coverage that, like Vanessa said, it was something that couldn't be denied. And so then you do end up looking back on your past in the sport, because for all of us, we start very young, and we've stayed in for so long that it is a huge part of us. And, you know, thinking about how can we make that better, because these young kids growing up, in sport, we have this ideal of fairness and you know, participating without discrimination. And we want that experience to be common.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a really, really strong point. The realities of being in something, you know, I think skating is that sport. It's one of those sports where you do start very, very young, right? Like what's a typical age, would you say, for someone who is really competitive, what's a general age that they would have maybe entered the sport?
Well, I started at the age of 6. And I think a lot of us have that in common. We start at, you know, 4 or 5 years old. And as the sport is moving forward, it's getting younger and younger. And you need to start younger, an advantage, because the later you start, the harder it is.
Yeah, I don't even think that I was running like full tilt at age 4, 5, or 6. So that's impressive. Okay, so, you know, when I think about what you folks have just expressed in terms of this opportunity to have this conversation and the dialogue that's happening in our day-to-day lives around these issues, and then bringing it back really to home in skating. And the fact that, you know, and a few of you mentioned this, that when you reflected upon your own relationship with skating and your own experiences, you were then able to identify some things that maybe you hadn't really reflected on before, or maybe you wouldn't have contextualized the same way previously. And so I'm wondering if you can kind of share, specific to skating, what does that even look like? What does racism, discrimination, sexism, what does that even look like in skating? And, you know, I really want folks to be as raw, as open, as direct as possible, because I think a lot of folks have an idea of what racism or microaggressions or oppression in these spaces might look like, but it's another thing to have lived it, especially from being really young throughout your adult life. So I'm not sure who wants to start. Maybe if Andrea, if you wouldn't mind starting us off.
Sure, I just, again, I was brought up in this world to kind of, in figure skating, and I just turned the other way, I guess, and suppressed a lot of things that didn't seem normal. But you learn how to just put it behind you and move forward, whether it be bullying, name calling, you know, being centered out for whatever reason. And I just grew up thinking that was so normal, that right now, or I guess in an adult stage in my life, realizing it wasn't okay, it's not normal, it shouldn't be like that. Mm-hmm. So
the kind of culture, there was a culture in sport for you where, and now those experiences, like, were those specific to you being, you know, a BIPOC person, like a racialized person, or do you, like, is it a gender thing? Is it both? Is it all? Like, what specifically for you do you feel were sort of the reasons for some of the ways that you were treated?
So I just remember, like, I remember there was one competition, this is for free skate, and I was really young. I think I was like 9, out of town, And I went to the change room after I skated, and there was two girls in there, and I was looking to wipe my blades, my towel. I couldn't find it. And they said, "Your towel's in the trash where you belong." Mm-hmm. So at that point, I didn't know if it was me, if it was my color of my skin, you know, what it was, but things like that sort. Or again, in the washroom, this is when I was on black ice, and there were two, I guess, moms maybe. And they took one look at me and they said, "I guess black ice is taking anyone now."
Wow.
So, yeah.
Wow.
I mean, that's when those things happen and you're a teenager at that point, you know, like 15, you start to kind of open your eyes and realize, oh, it's how I look, I guess. Or
Okay. So at some point you start to put these experiences together.
Yeah. Yeah. It was like pieces. Right. And just there was always a common denominator, I think, for me. So yeah.
I'm sorry. Those experiences are terrible. And you know, I know that in this conversation, in this dialogue today, people are gonna share really tough experiences they've had. And you know, hopefully this conversation, as uncomfortable and challenging as it is, will allow for other folks to be honest and open about their realities so that we can mitigate these harms from happening and, you know, move skating in a direction where those things don't happen. So thank you for sharing that. Is there anyone else like that can contribute to this part of the conversation? Like what is it exactly that we're talking about here? What is it exactly in skating that is affecting Black, Indigenous, and people of color still to this day?
I think that question is something that I myself had to dive deeper into once I started looking back at my own career and how things affected me and what I had experienced. I think skating society does a really, and skating is does a really good job at not allowing you sometimes to see how these things are affecting you or how they are coming towards you in a way that you really are not conscious of it. You might not notice, but if you look back and you really think of it, you can start to identify certain things. And so, you know, looking back as to my, you know, my experience just in terms of, you know, living some sort of discrimination or making fun of, you know, I wouldn't say that there is a lot that I experienced, but looking back, I can 100% remember moments where, you know, always being referred to as looking like a monkey when I skate. Always. I had long arms. I didn't have the right posture. I wasn't necessarily the graceful skater that, you know, that everyone or most people that I competed with skated like. And so always being referred to as a monkey or, you know, being told to cut my hair because it looks nappy, it looks dirty. It's not clean, right? I should cut my hair. The judges will like it. And then on the other side, being told that I was a good jumper only because I was Black. It's a compliment, but that's also rooted in racism, right? Absolutely. And so it's, you know, you start looking at all these little things and you start noticing that, you know, there's been situations that you've experienced racism, but in a very subtle way. Or even, you know, for me being half Russian, there was constantly this shift between, you know, the Russian culture in figure skating and then my African culture. And growing up, being around my white friends and being told, you know, oh, well, you're not like all the other Black people, you know, mm-hmm. you're different. You're not like the other Black people. Basically looking at the white in me and not acknowledging or accepting the Black in me. So all these little things, I think, you know, are things that I look back that I had affected me. And again, it's not in the moment because you brush it off, you laugh it off, you do it in ways to, you know, to not make it feel weird or awkward, but you internalize it in a way that that then can come back when you look back into it. But I think on a more subtle level, I think skating is, it's really hard in terms of competition and judging and all these conversations. It's really hard to quantify what racism looks like because it's a subjective sport. It's a sport that, you know, if you get a certain mark, It could be so many things. It could be your choreography, it could be this, it could be that, but it could also be your color. And that's a question that I think people of color sometimes have in the back of their mind, like, is this potentially a reason why I got this mark? And just that aspect, I think, you know, creates a world in which it doesn't allow for the BIPOC skater to potentially find themselves or be themselves or and to accept themselves. Yeah, and then you can dive deeper into lack of representation in so many ways. But I think, you know, I think that it's hard to, as a young Black or BIPOC skater, if you don't see yourself in someone that's successful in your sport, to actually believe that you can do it, you know. And I know for myself, for the longest time, it was crazy because I'm 5'7", I'm not super tall, but in my mind, I was going to be, I know. And I give that to my skates, but honestly, I thought I was going to be a basketball player. That's literally what I thought I was going to be, because in my mind, I saw successful Black basketball players, and it was cool, and you could be cool in that environment and in that world and be successful, or rapper, or breakdancer, or hip-hop dancer. Those are all things that I imagined myself being, even though I was already national champion in pre-novice and figure skating. I still didn't necessarily see myself as going to be one day a champion in that sport, and I actually wanted to potentially do something else. And that's what lack of representation actually looks like.
It does to you.
So that's
interesting, because, you know, there's a couple of things that you touched on just now that are, I think, so important to this conversation, and representation is a big part of that, right? Like, where do you envision yourself being in the world if you never see yourself reflected in it? And, you know, and the realities also of being a Black person, being a person of color, being Indigenous in this realm, and the specific ways you experience microaggressions or racism or discrimination. It's a heavy burden. It's a very heavy burden for people to carry. And it kind of cued for me thinking about intersectionality, and that, you know, we don't all experience, you all don't experience and haven't experienced discrimination in the same ways. You're not all the same people. And when I think about intersectionality, the fact that there are some folks whose identities, you know, the reality of it is such that they may experience different kinds of oppressions at the same time, right? Like, you know, Alaj, what you may experience in terms of racism may not be the same as what Vanessa experiences, you know, dealing with sexism and misogyny and being a Black woman, you know, in the skating world. And so I'm wondering, with that in mind, you know, thinking about intersectionality, thinking about the intersections of multiple kinds of oppression or challenges that way, I'm wondering, you know, if you can kind of speak to what that might be like in the skating world, either, you know, maybe Megan or Vanessa, if you want to take this one, you know, what did that look like for you, and how do you see that functioning, you know, for folks who are dealing with a multitude of these things potentially in skating?
Megan, would you like to go first?
I think it's difficult to separate sometimes too. Okay. You know, and in figure skating, we're a pretty female-dominated sport as well. You know, even as growing up, if you're looking at the kids, there are, you know, so many little girls and very few little boys. So. It's a little bit different than, say, in maybe perhaps in basketball, but I'm not exactly sure. But, you know, so there are quite a few women in high up positions, not the highest necessarily, you know, it has changed over the years as well, of course. So there is sexism for sure. But I experienced more racism. Mm-hmm. And not so much early on, or else I don't remember it, or I didn't really pay attention to it that closely, but more later on in my career, you know, when we were traveling to other countries, or you know, getting more monitoring and things like that, like more judge involvement in our careers, you know, so feedback from generally powerful white males, and giving their opinion on whether you know, even if the match looks good, or if, you know, you should be, you know, something looks a little off in this match with, you know, a Caucasian male and an Asian woman, or whatever it might be. And even as a coach myself, I've experienced that where people approach me and say, why did you put those two together? You know, those two kids together, that doesn't look right. You know, maybe two Asians together, something like that. And, you know, it was a bit eye-opening to think, it was surprising to see, unfortunately, how often people fall back on these stereotypes of what mm-hmm. looks good together, mm-hmm. Or what looks appropriate on the ice. And, you know, we are in a judge sport. So yeah. It's tricky because is it racism or is it something else? Or, you know, it's hard to tell sometimes. Other times it's pretty blatant. But I think it's hard to pull apart the different things that you might be experiencing. It just perhaps with the nature of figure skating itself.
Okay. Patrick, Vanessa?
Yes.
Yeah.
As for me, I mean, when people look at me, they definitely don't think I'm a figure skater, and then a high level figure skater, like out of the question, like never crossed their minds. So, you have to be very strong-willed as a Black female figure skater because no one expects anything of you. They always think that, you know, you'd be better off doing something else. And then you have to, I mean, I've heard people say, well, you have to be better. You have to work more on your extension because we see your legs better on the ice. We can see that your leg's not straight or things like that, you know? So it's hard sometimes, exactly what Elijah and Megan have said, that to really understand what's racism and what is just figure skating, you know, traditional, what's thought to be beautiful or, you know, are graceful. And so I feel in the last few years, I've kind of broken a little bit of those barriers with my skating partner. Just, you know, bringing a different feel of skating, music, it's more urban, it's modern. The outfits, you know, not hiding behind what is expected of. In the last few years, I've kind of grown and pushed boundaries in my own skating and my style. So, yeah, it's hard to distinguish certain things within our sport just because it's also subconscious, you know, things like I straightened my hair because okay. I don't know. Is it because I like my hair straight, or is that all we see, right? Yeah. Certain types of music choices, things like that. We have been so groomed, you know, by our surroundings and by this society and figure skating. So it's complicated sometimes, but I feel like I've been really lucky to be on the French team where there's so much diversity from Shafik Bezeguet, is Algerian, and Florent Mario, who's Brazilian, and Mae Mete, who is from Ivory Coast, you know, so, and we're not just skaters that are skating that exist. We have excelled in figure skating. These are elite Black and BIPOC skaters, so okay. I think we're pushing for change.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I mean, I would imagine that would be kind of nerve-wracking. Like, it's amazing to do sort of the groundbreaking, boundary-pushing work. And it, to me, it's like, that's super exciting. That sounds amazing. At the same time, I would imagine it might feel risky. Like, does it ever feel risky to you, or?
Definitely. You have to try and put yourself out there. You never know what's going to be said, or if it's going to be, you know, unappreciated and things like that. And I think Florent Mario, speaking of him, was the first person to ever skate to lyrics, and it was against all of the rules in figure skating. And then I think in the next Olympics we're allowed to skate to lyrics, so we have to. And he is, like I said, he's a Brazilian guy, brown, beautiful skater, and he pushed the limits. He didn't know what consequences he may have had, but he he broke that barrier for us. And now we're all skating to lyrics and these different musics, and it's more urban, it's younger, and it's bringing this whole different demographic to figure skating, which is so important. So yeah, while it's risky, it's worth the risk.
That's beautiful. Yeah, that's so powerful. And then I want to go to Patrick, and then Elaj, I saw your hand up, and we'll go to you right after Patrick.
Yeah, I mean, reflecting on my life in figure skating, I mean, I come from parents that are, I'm a first generation Canadian, and both my parents immigrated from China. And I think there was a bit of an identity crisis of just not knowing, you know, am I Canadian or am I Chinese? And when I got into figure skating, it felt like I always had to, again, it's all subconscious. It's all very, this all happens subconsciously, where you feel like I need to become more sophisticated and carry my, I remember my first coach, Mr. Colson, and, you know, I took etiquette classes because I had to be going to speaking to judges and going to galas for figure skating events, having to create this certain persona of being proper and very well-mannered. Now, his intention wasn't to be racist, I don't think, but he came from a very different generation and a very old school time in figure skating. And there's so many moments in my career where I do feel that for a long time in my early adolescence and going to international events, I kind of almost wanting to hide my mom away. She traveled with me because I was so young. She would travel with me to all my international events. And I felt almost this this desire to separate myself from my mother and kind of hide her in a way because I didn't want people to see that she spoke with an accent or that she was very a pushy parent, a very pushy Asian parent. So there was many times where this all happened so behind the scenes and very quietly, very slowly, and it just built and built over time.
Wow. Okay. I think so many first generation kids, I'm a first gen kid, can relate to some of those experiences and trying to navigate different worlds and figuring out exactly how you fit and how you're being perceived and taking on so much of that when you shouldn't have to, right? But thank you so much for sharing that. And shout out to your mom. Elaj, you had a question. Your hand was up anyway.
Yeah, no, my hand was up because I just wanted to, and I really connected with what Patrick was saying, I think, Kuzoma, you know, and maybe we'll get back into that a bit later. But my question was to Vanessa and Andrea, and just in terms of going back to intersectionality and, you know, for example, me going into competition or needing to get a costume or being part of a show, I don't have to worry that much about, you know, am I going to get the right color for my skin and all these things. And I know being a woman in figure skating, that's a whole thing that walking into a pro shop, most of the time you won't find, you know, types of your color. And that's pretty much everywhere in the world. And, you know, hearing stories from some of the people I work with that went on and did shows and were principals in shows, so the highest role, but then not necessarily having costumes that were made for them and having to use someone else's costume, but then it looked like completely different. So that whole aspect, I think, is something that I obviously I would love to hear from Andrea and Vanessa, what that looks like and feels like for them.
Andrea, do you want to go?
You can start.
definitely, that's a big issue still today. I remember I still have videos of me wearing these light tan tights, you know, the rest of my body did not match. And I think a lot of kids are still having those difficulties today. You can go into a pro shop and it's telling you, you don't belong. They have all these mess dresses. And then what do we do with them? You know, we have to get custom outfits. You can't return them, things like that. You have to go looking online and trying to get tights, paying $20 extra for one pair of tights, you know. So, I mean, it's really important to give back. I've been, you know, finding these tights and sending them to kids and things like that because I know what they're going through. Makeup, when we go to shows, like, I'm scared that they're not going to have a color that suits my skin. So I bring my tights, I bring my dresses, I bring my makeup, which shouldn't be the burden nowadays in 2020, you know, but it still is. So it is a battle that we're trying to fight with DIA, you being the president. So it is a good question. And we're fighting the battle, you know.
Yeah, I've seen the FSDIA stuff, and I think that's great that you guys are having this voice on a platform. I know, same as Vanessa, like, paid extra for that tight pair of tights, and God forbid you get any hole in it, you would just get in so much trouble. And I just know all of the skating pictures my mom has of me at home, it's, you know, white compared to me, legs, and all my dresses, well, for synchro, there was no option, so it would never, ever be remotely close. I know I see skaters, even Vanessa, I've seen some of yours now. It's closer. I think we're developing, and I'm so grateful that young, you know, BIPOC skaters now have an opportunity to get something more toned to their skin. But I was told or asked to maybe think of lightening my makeup when I was skating, so that I didn't look as different, I guess, was the comment, which hurts, but again, you kind of just laugh it off like, oh yeah, okay, maybe. But I definitely remember certain outfits and being super nervous to put them on, because I just knew it wasn't gonna be a good time. Yeah. Even when the dresses were sleeveless, with a synchro team, I mean, you're holding on, you have to be identical, and already I'm sticking out. So just to touch on something that we mentioned earlier, you kind of wonder, like, did we get a low mark because I didn't look the same? Or did we get a low mark because the team didn't actually skate well? So definitely can attest to that.
Those are challenges that just, you know, when you think about how competitive the sport already is and how difficult it can be to, you know, whether financially to act support, you know, whatever it is, and then you add on these additional stressors and then financial stressors and trying to find solutions to these issues around how you can be most comfortable in the beautiful skin that you're in. Is just, it's a compounding impact. And it's wonderful to know that work is being done to help alleviate some of that, especially for young folks who, you know, shouldn't have to navigate all of those barriers and all of those stressors. In 2020, you know, that these are still issues. And so something that has come up now several times in this conversation, and when I think about conversations around racism and race and all of these things, you know, one of the things we have to be able to talk about is power and who has power and how does that affect us within the sport and how we navigate the sport. And adjudication has come up now several times. And Megan, you said something you touched on something that I think is really important. You talked about representation of girls and women in the sport, but then you said, well, maybe not so much higher up. And I want to go back to that a little bit. So are you talking specifically about, you know, who's president of X, Y, and Z, who's sitting on all these adjudication panels? You're nodding. Okay. So can we talk a bit about what that means, like the realities of who's in positions of power in skating, who is adjudicating and what that means? I'm going to venture a guess that it's predominantly white people, maybe predominantly white men.
As far as positions of power, yes, in organizations, I'd say predominantly white men. Okay. On our judging panels, there are a lot of women. Okay. And I think nowadays, it's panels are a little more mixed and younger. Okay. In the past, when I was growing up, it was a different kind of looking panel. So
Be explicit, Megan.
Well,
what do you mean?
I think it was because I was young, though, too. But I feel like the panels were older generally, or maybe fewer judges at the top were getting out. So it was more the same people you would see at like the same set, let's say, of you know, the judge from whatever country. It's the same person that goes everywhere. Even in Canada now, we're sending out more, like a greater number of judges to events, I would say, than in the past, plus there are more events. But in the past, it seemed like there were fewer at the top. So there were maybe like three Canadian dance judges, let's say, who really were in it and were more or less in control of the judging in Canada. There were still other judges, but they're not the ones that would go to the internationals, not the big ones that would do your monitoring and whatnot. These days, it's a little bit different. Younger, more judges as well, and more variety. As far as administration, I do think it's more white male.
Okay. And what does that mean? So when that's the composition of administration, when that's the composition of adjudication, what are the impacts of that? What does that mean for you all as competitive skaters? How does that impact? I think we kind of have a sense already in terms of, you know, Andrea, you talked about it, the way you process, well, did I get this score because of this, or did I get it because of that, or how am I being perceived? But, you know, can anyone else speak to maybe what the impacts of that kind of culture in adjudication and administration, what the impacts are of that?
Yeah. Do you want to go, Vanessa?
Oh, well, yeah, I'll start. I think it's important that we have people of color on the judging panel in federations, because we can always start at the grassroots, but to create equity, we need to start at the top. We have to start at the top. We have to have people that are not okay with the status quo, that want to create change, find, you know, these financial avenues for lower socioeconomic groups. So yeah, we need people that can, you know, relate to these kids that, and just, it comes back to representation, being able to understand and appreciate like different choreography or artistic or interpretation, so that these kids feel welcomed, encouraged, and, you know, appreciated for their background, their cultures, and their style. So I think it's a really important step to start at the top.
Okay.
Yeah, I would agree 100%. And I think also, you know, with at the top, having, you know, white men kind of setting the tone as to what the sport looks like, what it does, I think, on a competitive level, it creates a box that you have to fit in. And because it's such a artistic sport and a subjective sport, those, you know, the people who are running this sport or these organizations are viewing it from a certain lens, and that lens doesn't allow for a BIPOC skater to truly deeply know itself and again perform from a space that is authentic and that is real. And so, you know, the shift in representation on a judging panel and on a, you know, on an organizational level at the top is, like Vanessa said, is crucial institutionally for the sport to be able to start changing and to start feeling like that box can dissolve and actually, you know, allow for more for more skaters to come in and enjoy.
Yeah. Patrick, I see you nodding.
Yeah. I think judges and skating, it's a very hierarchical system. As a up and coming skater, and even at the highest level, whatever the judge says, you do. And they are the top, and they decide everything. And there's always this fear that you associate with judges. So on top of that, we have a very subjective sport in terms of the artistic side. So appreciating the movement, the art, the music, the interpretation. And how is it fair that it's always white, predominantly white, judges who are making these big decisions and actually directing the sport? They have a lot of power in terms of how the sport moves forward and the future of the sport. So how can you have a diverse group of skaters when the decisions are catered around white individuals. And even then, like, I know there might be people who argue, yes, there's a lot more Asian representation in on panels now because of how successful skaters are in Japan and China and Korea. So there's a lot more representation. But I've never seen once in my life, and yet to this day, a Black judge or an indigenous representation on the panel. Who are making, and they have a lot to offer, and everyone appreciates art and music in their own unique way. So why not have more diversity on the panel?
I think that is such a powerful point, you know, that representation and representation in positions of power and authority and decision making is critical to moving in a direction of equity and equality and true fairness. But your point, Patrick, about, you know, it's one thing to see an increase in representation of one group of folks, but we have to pay attention to and be aware of the ongoing lack of representation of other folks. And what does that mean? Again, because we're not a monolith, right? Like, even within the Black community, African community, very, very dynamic and diverse and big differences, you know, within that. And so how do we make sure that representation is happening at all levels, including positions of power and authority and decision making, and that it's happening in a way that advances all communities, you know, all identities? And so that's a huge question that I'm asking all of you. How does that happen, you know, within the sport, not just for youth who are competing, but what do you think are some concrete steps that can be taken? You know, or what are some things that we need to see happen in order to also increase representation at the level of that kind of decision making, at the level of that kind of power? And I think I want to start with Andrea this time, if that's okay.
So I know we kind of touched on it previously, but I just think that a lot of us are left traumatized maybe after our figure skating life and experiences, and you almost maybe don't want anything to do with it. So I feel like judges were past skaters, especially in this day and age, you know, so they have some type of knowledge. And I think that's why diversifying the ice is so important right now. If we diversify the ice, then we're going to get more positive feedback and positive experiences that makes them want to stay in our sport to then become a judge. I know I have no inkling to judge. I'm the nurture side. I'm the coach on the side. But I just think it's about getting the word out there that skating literally is for everyone. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to look a certain way or fit a certain box to sit on that panel.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. Patrick, I see you nodding a lot as well to that. Do you have some thoughts on that?
I think a big part of bringing more diversity is the financial stress of skating, the equitable side of skating. I think we all have our own stories of our parents sacrificing a lot of time, a lot of emotional energy, and of course finance, the financial side of things. My parents took out 3-4 line of credits to pay for my coaching and pay for my travels. Already it's skating has this, it's not attainable for a lot of families because of the cost of just pretty much everything. There's nothing that's cheap in skating. And you're denying such a big population of BIPOC individuals right off the bat, because it's just not possible. Parents are gonna spend money on what's necessary, and skating is sometimes seen as a luxury.
Well, it's definitely seen as I know, you know, growing up watching skating, I always saw it as that sort of elite, luxurious sport, fancy sport. And it's the cost would be, of course, an astronomical barriers. And we know which communities are disproportionately socioeconomically more disadvantaged in our communities and in our country. So, you know, I guess, yeah, for sure, eliminating those barriers, reducing those barriers around cost makes a whole lot of sense. And Megan, I see your hand up there. You have a question, comment?
Yeah, I agree with Patrick as far as getting, so the diversity has to come in at the lower levels, the grassroots levels. And so if we want to see people in the administrative sort of positions and the ones who are in power and or on the judging panel, mm-hmm. if we want a diversity there, then I think it really does have to happen at the bottom, because I can't think of many high level elite skaters competitively that mm-hmm. end up judging. It doesn't happen that often. Mm-hmm. So those judges are not the ones necessarily that are making it to the top because they competed themselves up there and then transferred over. Often the people that were high level skaters, they go into maybe coaching or possibly on the technical mm-hmm. side of judging. But the judges are from that a different tier, I guess, maybe a little bit more grassroots. So it'd be keeping those people in and involved at those levels. I think that's key, and having more people, more diversity there.
Okay, and what is that, Vanessa? Can you talk a little bit, because I saw you really react there to what Megan just said. Can you talk a bit more about what that needs to look like at the grassroots level? Like, what's the stream then to increase representation in that way at a younger level?
Well, I do know that it's a completely different structure in Europe, per se. France, it's so diverse. Okay. It's normal. We don't see a lack of minorities in figure skating in France. And I think that has to do with it's government funded. You know, it's not, these parents are not paying thousands of dollars a week for private lessons and skates and things like that. Mm-hmm. So it, like Patrick said, it's financial, because we can get these kids skating, but then mm-hmm. how do they continue? How do we retain them in the sport? And that comes back to equity. It's just, we have to find a way to get it cheaper for everyone, you know, for these kids that love skating and can't make it to nationals, or because their parents can't afford it, make mm-hmm. it to international competitions, you know. And that's why, yeah, we don't have these judges, we don't have people in administration and stuff like that, these people in power, because they don't get to the level where they actually can invest and give back to the sport, right? Yeah. So yeah, she's completely right, but it always comes back to finances. So. Okay.
And is that something, you know, I think about, and Elijah, I see you, you're reacting, I'm going to go to you right away. I think about, you know, a different ice sport, but hockey, and all of these huge campaigns, like at the municipal level, provincial level, federal level, all of these campaigns, professional, you know, NHL, around making the sport more inclusive, around making sure it's more accessible for communities that are maybe, like I said, economically not as advantaged. And so are those sort of efforts being made? And I know that Elijah, you know, you co-founded an organization that is doing a lot of that work already. I believe Vanessa, you're a part of that as well. Yeah. Okay. So are there organizations and efforts being made that recognize cost as a barrier and are actively working to reduce, eliminate that barrier to create greater access in the sport?
Absolutely. I think that And this is where I think, just from my experience growing up, me being a Black figure skater, I'd never really encountered an organization that was potentially there in figure skating to help me grow in my sport and helping me financially in certain ways. And so I think one of our biggest missions with Vanessa and FSDIA is to bring that type of support to communities that don't have those opportunities, because without that, there's nowhere to go. For even me personally, if it wasn't for my coaches at some point literally not charging me for 4 years because my parents couldn't pay for it, right? Like it takes that kind of drastic sometimes measures in order for someone to succeed. And so not everyone can do that, not everyone will do that. And so if we can start collaborating between organizations, with FSDI in collaboration with Skate Canada, with some organizations in the US, you know, coming together to create this environment where we can help BIPOC community, BIPOC skaters, to have access just on a much easier level. And I think, you know, the points that that everyone was bringing up on the financial on an economic standpoint is probably one of the single most important things in seeing more diversity, seeing more equity and diversity within the sport. And to add to that on top, I think in certain ways, the culture of figure skating needs to shift. The culture of this elitist, white, supremacist, European type of world needs to shift, needs to it needs to start at, it's almost like it needs to happen at the top, it needs to happen at the bottom, and then in between there needs to be someone shoveling the snow in order to make to make a path for those for BIPOC skaters to really find their way within this sport.
I that was a really, you really illustrated and articulated that really well, and the shoveling, the seasonally appropriate as well with the shoveling the snow. Okay, so I'm really curious then, and you touched on something just then, Elaj, that I think any athlete that, you know, if you're a Black athlete, Indigenous athlete, an athlete of color, mentorship can be the game changer, right? It can be the support, the connection that helps keep you safe, helps keep you rooted, and helps lift you up in the sport. And so can you maybe talk a little bit about whether or not you had mentorship that affirmed you in your identity as a skater, and or, you know, what that needs to look like moving forward for athletes to be safe and to feel affirmed in the skin they're in, the beautiful skin they're in within skating.
Yeah.
And maybe we'll start with, Elaj, you want to go right away? I see you.
Yeah, I didn't know if you were throwing it back to me or not.
Well, right. So.
But I personally, you know, and this is where, in a way, lack of representation bleeds into, you know, lack of mentorship in certain ways. I definitely didn't have anyone that I could look up to or speak to or be mentored by that I could truly identify with and connect with. Mm-hmm. And I remember the first time that I actually felt a deep connection to another skater was this Quebec skater, Maxime Billy-Fortin, who is, I think he's from Haiti. He's originally from Haiti. He was adopted here in Quebec. But I saw him skate. I saw his style. I saw his power. I saw his rawness. And I was just like, fell in love with that. And I was like, oh my God, I'd never seen that. And I'd never been able to connect to a skater in that way, where I was like, I can do that too. And actually what he's doing is really cool. And I'd never seen that before. And why can I not be different too and be cool as well in that way? And, but before that, I was in a state where I had done everything to not be who I was. I was constant. I went so deep that I changed the way I talked, the way I walked, the way I dressed, what type of music I listened to, the way I interacted with people, all that to fit into a sport that for me had told me my whole life looked like this. This is what this sport looks like. And this is what the people that succeed in the sport, this is what they look like. And so subconsciously, I did everything to switch that, to change all of that so that I could fit more of that identity. And when I saw Maxime Billy-Fortin, it sparked this thing in me that was like, okay, I actually want to dive deeper into what I actually want and I actually want to do. And I remember there was a time when I was 12 years old where I was told to skate to African music, and I felt really awkward about it. Whereas my father is from Africa, and I didn't know, and looking back, I didn't fully understand why, but I understood that within figure skating at that time, being young and seeing what everyone was doing an African program was so out of the, it was so not what people did. And so it made me truly uncomfortable. But then doing that, you know, 8 years later, and actually wanting to now skate to African music and embracing that and going deep into my roots and my dad's culture and sharing that with the world, sharing that with an audience, that came from a different space. And then that allowed me to fully be authentic and be real. And so I think the whole concept of mentorship is super important. That's something that Vanessa and I were working on really, really hard in starting these mentorship programs, that we can bridge the gap between the skaters, the BIPOC skaters that have a certain level of success, or and whatever success means. It doesn't mean Olympics, it doesn't mean world medal, it doesn't mean any of that, but someone who's been in the sport, who understands the sport and who can inspire other skaters, and then bridging the gap between them and the new generation, the younger generation of skaters, and actually helping them through their process, helping them through their path, and telling them that they can actually be successful and be who, while being, maintaining who they are and being who they are and being authentic to themselves.
And that's it. That's so big. That's so much bigger than so many people will realize. But if you know just how significant that is. And I'm wondering if Megan, if you can speak a little bit to that. And I know that you're doing a lot of coaching. Mm-hmm. And so in your capacity as well as a coach, you know, for you through your career, was mentorship there for you in the ways you needed in terms of affirming your identity? And now in, at this stage, being a coach and being a go-to coach, you know, what does it need to look like for athletes, you know, in the sport?
I think for myself, no, I didn't really have a particular mentor. I mean, I had a lot of great coaches over the years, but not really a mentor. But I think now the landscape has changed quite a bit of figure skating in Canada. But again, it's, you know, some groups, not others. So there should be this opportunity for skaters, younger skaters, to see themselves in the ones at the top. And the top might not be the top that they see on TV. It could be, you know, the top at their club. It could be the top in their section. It's just so that they can see, oh, there's something there ahead that I could see myself filling those kinds of roles as well.
Okay.
So I think, you know, on a smaller scale, that could also come into play. For myself, I didn't really, you know, from a biracial background and a very multicultural city, I didn't really feel different.
Okay.
So much when I was younger. When I moved away to a less multicultural figure skating landscape, then I experienced it a little bit more, feeling different. You know, there were lots of other Asian skaters in Vancouver, not like now. You know, now it's really not different at all, you know, but you know, back when I moved away in my teens, I did feel different. You know, I moved away to Montreal and you know, it was quite a big contrast. But I think these days, hopefully, the landscape is a little different. And also, even if there isn't somebody in your immediate vision, you know, on a daily basis in your club or in the section, maybe you do look up to those role models that you see at the top of their competitive game at Olympics and Worlds and whatnot, and be able to see, oh, okay, you know, I see some similarity there, or I could be this.
Yeah, for sure. Is there anybody else who has thoughts on that, experiences you want to share or want to talk about how mentorship can play a part in increasing representation?
Well, I mean, I growing up, I looked up to many male skaters, but the only one I could remember that was with an Asian background was Chen Zhengli. And he was, I remember he was, you know, third in the world and always never had the artistic ability. He always had the technical ability, could do a quad, maybe even one more quad more than anyone else. But he always lacked the performance and the artistry and the lines that maybe the more Caucasian folk might have. So he even to the end of his career, he was never, even if he made a bit more effort in improving that side of it, it never really stuck. And so that being said, I always looked, unfortunately, I looked towards more Caucasian role models. You know, Kirk, being in Canada, we have a wonderful history of figure skaters with Brian Orser, Kurt Browning, and Elvis Stoiko. So I didn't even do it consciously. I just looked up to them. And I hope I didn't do it on purpose, but I hope that through my career, I was able to inspire many other Chinese Canadian or American Chinese skaters that they could do it. They can get to the top and be amongst the elite. And I hope I continue that. And actually, it was always done not directly. I luckily just being on television and having an opportunity to show what I did. Mm-hmm. But now I think I want to get more involved in terms of conversation and making BIPOC people heard, make them feel heard, and make them feel like they're not alone in their journey. Even the best in the world, they've gone through their own challenges and or uncomfortable moments and or moments where they feel completely isolated. Those are all stories that I'm not very public about, and I think it's time now to make people hear those stories.
That's beautiful. I have to say, you know, yeah, clap for that. That's really important. And you know, there's a couple of things that have come up now that I think they're so generous. It's like such a generous value, this desire to want to share yourself with other people in a way that allows for them to feel seen and allows for them to feel like they can and they should. And, you know, Elijah, you touched on that with saying, he literally said, you know, sharing that part of myself with people and that really it, without even meaning it to, you know, I can tell you, Patrick, that being present and being visible and participating in these conversations, it absolutely affirms people and absolutely affirms their experiences and allows for them, I think, to walk out in the world and walk into the skating world with a bit more confidence, you know, that their experiences are valid and real and they have a place. And I do see your hand there, Megan. So we'll go to you.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that I think the more that BIPOC people are seen and heard, then not only do they feel like they belong, you know, all of us, and feel like we're part of the community, but also the stereotypes change. Mm-hmm. And I just think back to when, you know, Patrick, you were talking about one of the skaters you looked up to. I remember when I was growing up hearing that, well, Asian skaters, they can't emote. They have, you know, they can jump and they have the technical prowess, but there's no emotion there. They won't learn to act. You know, well, that changed over time significantly. And so I think that's one positive to look at. You know, things can really change over the time of, you know, however many years that would be, 20 years or so. And so the more representation on a wider scale, the broader the conversation is going to be, and the look of a skater, what's appropriate and what's possible in their, even in their skating alone, is going to change over time.
Okay. And Andrea, can we go to you? Are you okay if I run this one by you? Because, you know, before this panel, we had conversations leading up to it, and you talked about the realities of the style of sport that you competed in, right? That in synchro things, there are different pressures and maybe different things you have to process. And so I'm wondering if you can speak to a bit of what it means in that world, if you had mentorship or what it would mean, what it could mean, what it could do to have mentorship in that style of skate, especially for younger folks.
I'm in love with the idea of mentorship, like, and I would totally join that. I think it's essential. And I do think that I mentioned this to you in our previous conversations. I feel that the discipline of synchronized skating and figure skating is mm-hmm. already at a disadvantage because growing up, it was not preceded as a high level of skating. You know, there's the free skaters and the ice dancers and the pair skaters, and they do these incredible, amazing, awesome things. And synchro was just a bunch of, you know, lazy girls, and now there are guys in the sport. So I think for sure if I had anyone that looked like me, obviously, growing up, it would have meant so much. And I do remember one moment where I was just walking, it was at the Hershey Center at an event, and this little brown and black girl with their families stopped me and asked what my name was. They had the program of the competition, and I said, told them, you know, this is who I am, and can we get a picture with you? We saw you skate. You're such an inspiration. I think that was like the most humbling but also satisfying moment for me. I remember being a little girl and at Skate Canada, Megan, at those official practices, waiting for you and Aaron to come off to the side to sign my book. So for me to just have that role reversed and be in that level where I mattered to someone enough that they wanted a picture or acknowledgement and a thank you, you know, for being that, I think it'd be awesome if we had more of that representation, especially in synchro, just to get it more out there. Because again, I just feel like there are so many beautiful things about our sport, whether it's performing, competing, doing it for fun, and everyone needs to be exposed to all of it.
Yeah, that's so wonderful. That's, you know, I mean, you see the impact right there. It comes full circle where these kids are asking you for your autograph and for a photo. And I can tell just by your energy and getting to know you a little bit, Andrea, that you probably told those kids no. You probably said, go away.
Yeah, like, what are you doing?
It's really powerful. It's really wonderful. And definitely, you know, those kids are carrying that with them, right? And Vanessa, yes, you've got a comment question.
Yes, comment, because with FSDIA, we have are developing the Big Skater, Little Skater program for BIPOC skaters and mentors. So I think, Andrea, that you'd be a great addition to that.
Hey.
So put that out there if you'd like, because basically it's based on Big Brothers and Big Sisters of America, that mentorship program. And this is like, we are all sponsored by different brands of skates. And for every skate that they sponsor us, we will have that brand donate a pair of skates to a BIPOC skater. Wow. And along with that, they get a great mentor like Elage, myself, Patrick, or Andrea, Megan, to, you know, share their experiences, to motivate them, to empower them and let them know that they are not alone. And not only can they exist in the sport, they can excel. So I think that would be you'd be a great addition.
Thank you. I would love that. Cool.
That's pretty great. Well, okay. I think that, first of all, I think you're all amazing. I think this conversation has been just so impactful and powerful. I'm feeling empowered. I'm feeling like I'm going to go out to the rink and show my stuff. But really, it is. It's so uplifting, and it's just so... It's so gracious of you all to share these experiences from a place of wanting to enhance and improve and make the sport more inclusive. And it really resonates. And, you know, something that actually, Andrea, you mentioned earlier, you used a specific word, and I want to go to that because I think it's also really important for us to talk about the potential long-term impacts of, you know, microaggressions, of racism, of discrimination, of misogyny, you know, all of these things, and the burdens, the realities of the burdens and the barriers that BIPOC athletes face that maybe other folks just don't experience. And you use the word trauma in talking about, you know, sometimes how folks leave the sport, they exit the sport, and they leave with these experiences that don't stop just because you're no longer participating or involved in a certain way. And so trauma, we talk about trauma and the impacts of trauma, we're talking about mental health. I'm curious if that's something we can dive into right now, talking about the realities of, you know, lifelong participation in the sport that is adjudicated by, you know, so often folks who don't necessarily look like you, have your lived experience, navigating all of these things. So when we look at the impacts of all of what we've discussed today on the mental health of Black, Indigenous, and athletes of color, what is it that you would share with folks in terms of being able to take care of their mental health, being able to find support and resource for their mental health, if in fact that's something that you identify as an experience that is real for you or for folks that you know within the skating world?
Yeah, for sure. I have friends that were in the sport that just left it on a sour note because of things I've gone through or just, you know, experiences. I know myself, if I told you I didn't think about quitting several times, it was there for me. If I didn't have someone strong like my mom pushing me and cheering me on in the background, and not even in the background, very loudly, I don't know that I would have gotten to levels I did or continued on in the volunteer aspect that I do now or coaching. I do think that I've, in my adult age now, processed a lot that I went through, and I've tried to, you know, move forward from it. It's all about growth and learning. And I think that kids nowadays, mental health is more talked about, and I'm so glad for that, because I think that it wasn't publicized much back when I was skating, at least. So I just would hope that, and I want to share the message with young boys and girls that, you know, be comfortable with who you are, and it's okay to look the way you do, and it's really not a bad thing, because no one should feel bad about the way they look. So, I mean, if someone could have said that to me when I was skating, that would have, words of affirmation was my love language, and I just feel like that would have been empowering and uplifting if I heard that more.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense, absolutely. Megan, do you have any thoughts on that?
I just wanted to go back to the judging and bringing that in with the mental health of the skaters. You know, even if we don't have judges that share, or right away, like with some of the judges now, they might not share my lived experience. I have encountered some of these, the younger judges that are often working with like the junior national team kind of level athletes who are able to treat the skater and involve them and make them feel they're valued and cared for. And so even if someone doesn't have the same lived experience, it doesn't mean that it's not possible for them to give you the sense of belonging that all skaters, everybody should have.
And what do you think goes hand in hand with that? Like, I'm curious to know, because I agree with you. It is so important that regardless of whether or not you have that shared lived experience or similar or whatever it is, you have a responsibility to be able to create space where folks do feel affirmed and they feel welcome and safe and all of that. Is it, do you think, Megan, in your experience, is it those folks, you know, have had training or education that has allowed them to understand certain things or experiences in a way to do that? Or is it a certain culture of the sport that they were developed in? What do you think it is specifically that can contribute to just across the board folks being able to create space in that way for athletes?
I think that awareness does have a part in it. I'm not sure how much training has gone into these particular individuals that I'm thinking of. But I think possibly with figure skating and the selection of judges, as our association chooses which judges to go out and monitor and work with the kids, you know, closely, and even, you know, just going out to competitions, if judges can be chosen who are, you know, able to speak in a way that is respectful of the individual, then that's all good. I mean, you can't go wrong there. You know, I think the more judges that get promoted who have this personable, caring attitude, that should do well for everyone.
Okay, yeah, that makes a whole lot of sense. Makes a whole lot of sense. Elijah.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that, because Megan is bringing such an important point. And on the judges' side of things, I think one of the things that I think we, as, you know, the working group within Skate Canada and FSDIA, are trying to create some sort of educational plan that can in a way will be mandatory for example for all judges or for you know, for coaches, in a way that will allow the people who are dealing with or experiencing something with someone that's from the BIPOC community to relate more or to understand more, to potentially support them in a way that will help that skater go through whatever they're going through, or heal some of their trauma. And I think just in general, the sport of figure skating, there's so much. Andrea was saying earlier that, you know, leaving the sport, you have, you know, bad taste in your mouth. I think most skaters, I want to say 90% of the skaters I know, even myself, in a way, leave the sport and you feel, you know, you feel bitter about it. You don't, you feel like there's a certain layer of trauma that is there that you need to heal from. And then obviously, if you're from the BIPOC community, you know, there's your experience as a BIPOC skater. But I think the base of figure skating, because of, like you said, you know, it's a judged sport, because of that, there is a layer that is always there in figure skating that will create trauma in you. And I think there's an opportunity for a lot of skaters for all skaters to, in a way, leave the sport feeling a little bit more healed through their sense of fulfillment and where fulfillment comes from within their careers, right? So I think figure skating is, like most sports, it's a very competitive sport, but it's very much based in comparing yourself to others. And there's this constant idea that, you know, you need to be at this level in order to be good enough. And you're constantly looking at yourself and then looking at where you should be and knowing that you're not there, and then eventually potentially realizing you'll never get there. And so you feel like, in a way, you've wasted your career. So I think reshaping where fulfillment comes from within the figure skating experience is huge. And we have the opportunity as a sport that is half, 50% artistic, we have an opportunity to express ourselves and find fulfillment through artistry, which that is solely based on your experience with yourself and the sport, nothing else in the external world. And so, you know, this opportunity of being able to find true fulfillment through performance, through artistry, can help heal those wounds before you get out of the sport, and then get out of it and be a little bit in a better space.
Yeah, that makes a whole lot of sense to me, that you want to do that work before you exit the sport and you leave certainly much more fulfilled athlete. And that language makes a lot of sense. You know, I when I think about sport, I tell this to kids all the time, like, it should be fun. You should enjoy it. If it's not fun, if you don't enjoy it, you know, maybe you shouldn't be doing it, right? It shouldn't feel like a chore all the time. Sometimes it's a bit of a chore, but the foundation of it should be fun. And I think the language of saying fulfillment and where you draw that fulfillment from is so important. And that's probably a lesson that a lot of young athletes, a lot of young skaters need reinforced, about where are you drawing your fulfillment from. And did I see, was it Vanessa, did you want to make a comment? I thought I saw a hand go up for a second, but maybe I'm mistaken. No? Okay, well, Vanessa, Patrick, any thoughts on, you know, mental health in skating and post-skating and how to navigate that in a good way?
I think sport, first of all, it should be a safe haven for young athletes going through their own struggles outside of their sport. Yes. Figure skating or any other sport activity should be a release. And there needs to be an environment where you feel safe to do that. And that brings me to my next point, which, I mean, look to your peers. Figure skating is a very individual sport at times, but the community is quite small. So look to your friends, look to your peers. It's ironic because we live in a time where we're so connected yet disconnected from each other, where we're not using these tools that we have, the technology now, to have an open dialogue. There's still this a bit of like uncomfortable. I think some people have a hard time even speaking in person, face to face, having human interaction. It makes me think of like Elijah and I. We were lucky enough to have grown up in the sport through the junior levels through to the elite level together, and the conversation of just like unloading, just you'd be amazed how better you feel, whether or not there's a solution, just unloading and lifting this weight off of your shoulders and sharing it with someone else is sometimes all you need to help you get through it. And I just knowing that you're not the only one. And a lot of the time, Elijah and I would talk about the mental struggles and the mental challenges that come with the sport. And he's like, me too. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh my God, that's like so relieving to hear that I'm not the only one that has these same thoughts or these same insecurities. So look at what's around you and take the opportunity to just sit down and have a conversation.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, definitely. I agree with Patrick starting the conversation, having this conversation. It's still very therapeutic. I think it's going to be very therapeutic for people listening, and hopefully they're starting conversations with their peers and their colleagues. And I think, yes, we have a very small community, but during this time where people are listening and having conversations and digging deeper and, you know, second guessing what they've been taught or what they've heard, we've kind of found who our true friends are, and take comfort in that, because those people reaching out and changing their perspective and working on themselves and educating themselves are your friends. And I think we found that out really quickly during this whole like pandemic and everything that's been going on, this moment that we're trying to continue as a movement. So
that's a big statement, and I love that you just articulated that way, Vanessa, this moment we're trying to continue as a movement. And I, you know, something that was shared a lot over the summer months especially, and I kept hearing, and it's something that I certainly understand, is that we're actually experiencing the convergence of more than just one pandemic, right? It's a convergence of the pandemic that is COVID-19, unfortunately. And it's also this pandemic of systemic racism and discrimination, and the fact that it exists everywhere. And the only way we're going to address it is by identifying it, by talking about it, and by committing to collectively working to move in a direction away from it, move toward equity. And, you know, you said something that also really stands out to me, Vanessa, that this period of time has really given people an opportunity to express their position on things and to learn. You know, in the very beginning, we talked about listening. It's an opportunity for folks to listen. And, you know, what I see from you folks and from Skate Canada, which is really cool, is wanting to action, wanting to take concrete steps to not only have this dialogue, but make positive change. And so I'm wondering if maybe on almost a final note, if you folks could talk a bit about maybe two things really concisely. One, what message would you share now for young folks who are coming up in the sport, young Black, Indigenous, and athletes of color? What's the one message? You know, maybe it's something that you wish someone had said to you when you were coming up in the sport. Or maybe it's just something you think this is a really important thing for you to hear right now in this time. And then second thing is, very concisely, what is your vision for the sport? What's your big dream? What's your big hope? What's your big vision for skating? And I would say for skating in Canada specifically. So those two things. And I'm going to start with Megan.
Oh boy. Okay. Well, I guess my message would be for the youth who are in skating right now or might start skating, is that you belong. You belong in this sport. There is a place for you. And so not to doubt it, despite anything you may hear, but that you do belong. As far as the vision, I think the vision that I would like to see for skating in Canada is for kids to start skating, to again feel like they belong, and for more kids to be able to reach their potential in the sport, to their reach where they could possibly get or where they want to get in the sport, to face fewer obstacles that are outside factors.
Okay, makes sense. Yeah, for sure. And okay, next I'm going to go to you, Elijah.
Sure. I mean, I love what Megan said. I think for me, you know, the message of just be who you are and find your uniqueness and find pride in the fact that you're different and you have a way, you have your own story, and you can share your story in a way that's unique to you, and that's good enough, and that's perfect, and that's magic, and that you might feel, you might encounter resistance from a million different places, but stay true to that, stay true to your authenticity, and people will buy it eventually. You know, it'll come to a space where, you know, people will accept it. And once it's accepted, you know, it won't change how you feel about it because you already feel great about who you are, but you'll be allowed to be in a position where you can share it on a bigger platform. You can share it in a way that's going to reach more people. And I think for me, what it looks like is, you know, walking into a rink and seeing diversity, and but seeing diversity in a way that feels safe and feels warm and feels collective and feels like it's unified. And going to an international competition, looking at the podium and seeing diversity on the podium at that level as well, you know, I think, and then looking at judges and seeing diversity there, just seeing the sport becoming more colorful in a way, you know. And in Canada, we have the skaters, we have the communities to do that. And so we can do it in Canada. And I truly believe it.
Okay, thank you. Going to go to Patrick next, if that's okay.
Yeah. First of all, I think piggybacking off of Elage, I think we're all very unique. And we all, although we come from very specific cultures and colors, I think we're still within our communities very unique. And one thing that I feel like I could always fall back on was, thanks to my mom, was the push and the hard work and the determination. No matter how maybe you're not as artistic or maybe you're not as technically sound as another skater, but one thing that you can control is how hard you work. And that's the foundation of any activity in sports, is you give yourself the best chance when you put your head down and just grind away and do more than what your competitors are doing. Because at the end of the day, no matter the results, you can leave the sport with that knowledge or that confidence that you have what it takes to, and no matter what career you decide to pick. Yeah. Now, in terms of the sport and how I would like to envision it, I mean, I think we need to see individuals at the highest level, AKA the ISU, having open ears and having the willingness to listen to us who are at the bottom of the pyramid, to hear what we're saying. And we've lived it, so please, you need to hear what we're saying and what we've witnessed. I think enough of this, like, figure skating is we're hoity-toity and we're perfect and everything is you know, joyful and great, but there in anything, you got to be honest with ourselves and give us an environment and a place to have our voices heard, and then follow through with it.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much. Okay, we're going to go to Andrea, and then we're going to end with Vanessa. Andrea.
Well, I mean, there's so many great things that I've just taken notes on. Just on to add to all of that, agreed at the very top, I think we need to see more diversity. And as for youth and the kids, I just believe in letting everyone know you're worthy. Mm-hmm. You're worthy of competing, of skating, doing any sport, getting any job, like, you are worthy. And I also would tell them to celebrate themselves. I think we have to learn how to celebrate ourselves. And that's something that I'm now feeling more proud to do, especially sitting on this panel with such amazing individuals. And yeah, to celebrate you.
Okay, that's a powerful message. Thank you. And Vanessa.
So for the kids, we talk a lot about representation, but I want them to know that nobody has to do anything before them, for them to know that they are capable and they should be the first. So I know it's easier, but I want these kids to know you can be the first and you should. You can make a contribution to this sport. So find out what it is and do it. And for me, I always get emotional, but how I want to see the sport, I really commend Skate Canada for doing what they're doing today. Mm-hmm. They talked about it, but it's backed by action, and this is proof of it. So I commend them, and I hope that our sport, our federations, the ISU, are going to do the same work. Yes. That's what I want to see our sport do.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. Thank you to everyone. Thank you to everyone so much for sharing so openly, for being vulnerable in the ways that you're sharing and contributing to this conversation. This is important. This is important. And it's going to be an opportunity for people of all ages, all backgrounds, all levels of involvement in and out of skating to learn, to listen, and to move forward, and hopefully take action in their own ways, in their own capacity, to moving the sport in the direction of true equity. And so I want to thank each and every one of you for participating today. It's been an absolute pleasure and an honor to get to know each of you and to hold space with you in this way. Thank you for sharing your time, and thank you to Skate Canada. Yeah, you followed through. You done did it, and that's good. Keep it going. All right, everyone, take care. Stay safe. Stay well.
Thank you.
Thank you.